Good afternoon. My name is Evgeny, and today I want to talk with you about the security. I think the most difficult thing for any talk is how to start. The first idea was about the hackers. I mean, I'm from Russia, so who else can talk about the security about Russians? However, I'm in London, and I would say that the best example would be from Harry Potter. There was a very interesting person in these films and in these books. The name was Mad-Eye Moody. And his famous, his favorite statement was constant vigilance. So that is how we can protect ourselves against hackers. That is how we can gain, we can get the security of everything we are doing. The first question you might ask yourself, I mean, why should I care about the security? I mean, really, if you are doing some sort of social apps or small projects, why should I care about some hackers? The probability of hacking is really small. So why should every developer care about that? I don't think that every developer should care about that. However, the real question is, who should care? And like a football, I hope in London I can say football, not soccer, right? Okay, so like in football, the protection, the security is not about the developers only, it's about everyone in the team. It's a team play. It's a play of mid gamers, defenders, and goalkeepers, so it's a team play. So one of the easiest way how to hack your clients or your product is to hack SEO, because, I mean, the developers care about the software, but salesmen, businessmen, they care much less. So my talk would be about all kind of security, not only technical security we usually talk. It would be about all this stuff. Where the security is the most important? We are working a lot with FinTech products, and I would say that there are few areas, few industries that are extremely sensitive to the security problems. FinTech, because of financial data. MedTech, medical projects, medical startups. Educational technologies that are growing last years very rapidly. So all this information like passwords, social security numbers, transactions, investment portfolios, and so on, they are extremely sensitive to the security. If a fintech startup loses the data, it might be the last thing this startup would do. I mean, really, in fintech area, in medtech area, in educational tech area, the core principle is the trust. The users, your clients should trust you or your service or your product. If it is not the case, then you're gone. I would say that it is not possible to protect yourself from hackers. It is simply not possible to create something that would be extremely secure. Our mission as the developers, as managers, as testers, is not to create something very secure. Our mission is to make difficulties for hackers how to hack the system. So it's like an onion. You create different levels of defense. Like in football, you have mid defense players, you have the defenders, and you have the last line, you have the goalkeeper. The same should be here. The idea is to create the difficulties for the hackers, so if they want to hack you, it would take time, and you will get the same time to protect yourself and stop the attack. As I mentioned before, as developers, we usually care about technical level of security, like protecting ourselves against cross-site scripting, SQL injections, server breaking, and so on. However, there are three levels of security: physical, administrative, and technological. I would speak about all of them. Of course, I will focus on the last one because we are all about the development here. However, the first two are very important. And the point here is that we usually forget about that. We usually forget that the easiest way to hack you is simply to steal your computer.
That's really true. I don't need to decrypt. I don't need to know the passwords. I'll just take your computer. The same for phones. The same for everything REST. I mean, don't think that it is impossible. So here are the photos from this conference. I would be able to get all this information just sitting down with you. The person that was right to me was entering the password from mail client and project management tool. If I just record a video, I would get the password and the login. I would be able to use it. So this is the easiest way how to hack you. You should somehow protect yourself. I would say that there are three simple steps what you can do. The first thing is about lock your computer. I mean, really, use the password. Use normal big password to lock your computer. Use iWatch if you don't want to open it every time. Use fingerprint, whatever you want. But use the password for computer and phone the phone, because your phone is sometimes even more easy to take your phone or to hack your phone instead of the computer that is usually larger. The second thing is about encrypting your computer. Okay, even if you set up a computer, even if you have a password, if your disk is not encrypted, in this case, I just take your computer, take out your hard drive, and that's it. Here are the data. macOS supports, by default, the encryption. Just enable it. And even if someone would steal your computer, you still will be protected. And the third way, check your bag. I mean, of course, it is not a case. I'm pretty sure that nobody would hack you today. But if you would be a target of attack, if you are working in FinTech area, if you are working in any sensitive area, and I know that some of you are, so just check that you are not doing anything here on the public space. Another very common thing, it is mostly related to the CTOs or CEOs, is about the administrative part of the security. That's something we don't like as a developers because, I mean, who cares about the bureaucracy? That's always boring and non-interesting. But if you have a hacker attack, every second is important. You should know exactly what you will do if you see that something goes wrong. And based on my experience working with the developers, even the first step is very difficult. Even the first step just gets the information that something goes wrong because the usual scenario is, oh, it might be wrong, but I don't think that it would be a problem. Let's go forward. So having strict security policies, what should be done in what situation, that's something that you should have. And it is not related only to some strange things you can get in your monitoring system. That's also related to hiring process, firing process, onboarding, offboarding. So you should have some sort of steps, what you do for every new person who joins your team and who's going out. So it is very easy to forget something. And based on my experience, if you don't have a checklist, you will forget something for sure. So I just want to say here, I would focus next on the technical side, but these two levels, physical and administrative, are really important. It is easy to use them. Don't think that hackers do not have common sense. They would use the easiest way how to reach you. And these ways seems to be one of the most easiest. So let's talk a little bit about the technical side and about the security basics. If you don't use password manager system, that's not good, and the first thing you should do right after this talk is to install something like that on your computer and on your phone. I hope that nobody is using sticky notes nearby your computer is writing the password. However, keeping unencrypted notes, keeping notebook with your password is not the right way. And moreover, if you do not use any password manager, I'm pretty sure that a lot of your passwords would be the same for different websites, and that's a potential security leak. You can fix this issue completely just installing one of these software. There are free, there are paid, choose whenever you want. Another case is about transferring the data. I've seen that a lot of you were using Slack and Telegram, sometimes Skype. It is not secure to send any private information through the messenger application because I don't know from you, for you, but I've seen last year about 30 messages in Skype that one of the accounts was broken. And if you send anything through Skype, Slack, or Telegram, it basically means that if the account would be compromised, the person would be able to get all this private data. So the real answer is here, never, never send any sensitive information through any messengers, because it can be, in this case, hacked after that. So how to transfer then the information? There is an easy way how to do that. You should just send encrypted information. There are a few tools that can help you with that. One of the most famous is PostVault. So you just copy-paste sensitive information inside of it, set up password, any password, then create a private link, and you get this information encrypted. So you send a link in Slack or Skype. And this link will have expiration date. So after, for example, 24 hours, it will no longer work. So if anyone would hack you in 40 hours, so there would be no sense because the information has been already deleted. So if you just want to transfer the information, use any of these apps. Why there are two apps? Because this app was not updated for a long time, for 5 years, so we created our own based on Symfony. But anyway, feel free to use any of them. Both of them are free and very easy to use and to maintain. Another thing is about storing the password. I think that's very easy, but still, sometimes from young developers, I see that they store sensitive information in the repositories. For sure, that shouldn't be done, especially in case of public repositories or GitHub or Bitbucket. There was a very interesting case. I think it should be on the next slide, when a person created a private repository, but because of the bug in Visual Studio, the repository was not actually private, and the person lost $6,000 on Amazon because of Bitcoin mining in 20 minutes. But anyway, so the point here is never store any sensitive information in the repository. Here is an example on Pastebin. That's another thing we should not do. If you want to show someone the piece of the code, please don't use the websites like Pastebin or gist@github.com. Use private gist repositories. Use private gist on GitHub. Use private gist on private snippets on Bitbucket or anything that is under either protected by the password, either under your control. Because it is easy to send sensitive information on Pastebin. Here are three real screenshots. I found them in like 10 seconds. I just Googled on Pastebin for WordPress and even for Symfony. I've checked one of them, it worked. So I just have on Pastebin the real access to the server. So again, if you want to share the code, use something that is under your control or something that you are absolutely sure is protected. Don't use public service. The same is about the screenshots. A lot of us are using screenshot tools to show, for example, to testers the issue, or the testers are sending screenshots to the developers to show that something is wrong. So we are using a lot of screenshot tools. And the default setting is that the screenshots are stored somewhere in the cloud. So it basically means that they are public. Don't think that if the URL is private, and nobody knows this URL, that it is safe to keep that. That's actually not true. Another scenario is when something is stored on your servers, but still you are using short links, shortening of the URLs. That's another case. Again, this is not private, unless it is under your infrastructure. So if you use any screenshot tool, just enable something like save to Amazon S3. Create your Amazon account and just save all your screenshots there. You can set up your bucket, so in 2 weeks, for example, everything will be purged, so you don't need to pay a lot for storing these screenshots. I'm using Monosnap, and it has built in this function. I'm pretty sure that almost any screenshot tool should have it. So that's a very simple thing, but in my practice, there was one case when we almost lose the data because of a public screenshot. It was only once, but in my opinion, it was really enough to deny this for all. technology. So let's go a little bit deeper. One of the cases working with FinTech projects, and actually it is related to almost any industry, is about the data, PII, personal identifiers, personal information. And due to some regulations, for example, US regulations, it is not allowed to transfer the information outside of the country. So if you are storing the data of US citizens, you should keep the data in US. Even if you store them on Amazon, still as a developer, if you sit here in London, it is a violation of the rules. So the first thing is about the regulations. So it is difficult to sit here and work with personal data somewhere outside. The second thing is that usually, as the developers, we actually don't need the real data. I mean, what we really need? We need the structure, we need the connections, we need sometimes the volume, but we don't know. As a developer, I don't care, is this person John Doe or, I don't know, Ivan Petrov? It really doesn't matter. So the scenario is very simple. Let's do not use the real data at all. Let's use the following scenario. Imagine that you have a production data, production database. It might be anywhere on Amazon or on your own server, and you have as a developer in the left. So the idea is to obfuscate the production database. So you keep the structure, you keep all records, but in these records, there are no personal information. It fully satisfies almost all, at least US, regulation rules. And even if someone would steal the data from the developer computer, it actually doesn't break anything because there are no personal information on the developer's computer. So it makes our security policies much easier because in this case, the developer would have access to the production database, but still they, but there won't be any sensitive information inside of it. So how to do that? There are a few ways how to do that. There is a very cool library, unfortunately written in Ruby. There is also PHP library, but it is much simpler. I've tried both of them. We use the first one. However, the second one is also acceptable if you have a small project. So how it looks like? That's Ruby, but I'm not very familiar with Ruby, but I understand what's going on here, and I'm pretty sure that you would do too. So you spend like a couple of hours to understand what's going on, or you just hire a Ruby freelancer, and it creates some sort of configuration file for your database. You can do a lot of things here. You can do whitelists, you can do blacklists, you can even work with aggregation column, you can work with relations. It is guessing a lot, so that's really not difficult to set up. Even for large database, when we had like terabyte of information and more than 500 tables in the relational database, it was not so difficult to create such file. And generally, that's it. You do this obfuscation process, a part of your continuous delivery process. You get the new dumps from the production almost any time you need, and your developers can work with the real data instead of working with the sensitive ones. It also solves another problem. If you have a startup or a project from US and you are here in Europe, you still cannot have access to the production data. It is not allowed because of the regulations. So it is always a problem how to fix the bug, how to understand what's going wrong, and so on. With the obfuscation, you simply don't have this problem. So that's something. If you have feelings that your information might be sensitive, feel free to set up obfuscation process. It's like one time effort, and then continuous support that would take a couple of hours per month, and that's it. But you remove very strong risk of losing your sensitive information, especially when you have a lot of employees. So easy. Oh, sorry. I should move through this slide. Another way what you can do is to use some automatic tools. So it is not a problem when you have a very difficult security risk and you fail, because everyone realizes that it is not possible to be fully secure. However, if you fail in something simple, it really breaks the reputation. So I'm a big fan of automation the processes related to obfuscation and related to the security. I understand that these tools, there are a few tools that can help you with the automation of security processes. They cannot fix all potential security risks, but at least you would manage some of them. So it is always better to manage the risk you can automatically without any actual effort than trying to create something very difficult. So there are two tools. One is very famous, OWASP, and another one is Burp. The left one is open source and free. The right one has free version, has also paid version. What they do, they monitor your resources. They monitor your websites or products whenever you want, whatever you want, and provide you the reports. What's wrong? What's not wrong? What has been changed? So it's like continuous security testing. And you get some sort of such reports where you see all potential issues. That's, by the way, the real case. When you see all issues with the level of risk, like high, medium, low on informational. Even such small risk like password autocomplete in browser, it really matters too. So it helps you to maintain the security on really good level. And in terms of level of effort, that's really low. You just set up it once, and that's it. Another very interesting case is about storing the secret information. In every application, we have a lot of them. Of course, the connection to the database, the connection to the social networks, the client IDs and client keys, so a lot of sensitive information. There are a few ways how we can store them. The previous way that was used in Symfony years ago was related to storing this information in files, in parameter YAML, actually. I've already mentioned that it is not a good idea to store in the repository. However, you can store parameters YAML file on your server. It is still not a good idea because of two reasons. The first reason is that if someone gets a full copy of your production files somehow, all data would be there. So there is no need to look into anything else. And the second is that if somehow your server would be hacked, the first thing that the person would do is go to parameter YAML file to find the credentials. So let's go back to the onion pattern. The idea is not, it is not possible to hide the secrets, the secret information, because you still need access to it. But the idea is to hide it somehow, so it would be difficult for the potential hacker to find this information. So, therefore, the files are not really a good option. Actually, it's the same for the environment variables, because if the information is not in the files, then it should be somewhere in the environment. So the potential hacker would just dump the environment variables. Another point here is that other software might take the environment variables. There was an issue related to the Node.js a couple of months, I think, ago, when some packages were transferring the environment variables to the third-party websites. So there was such issue a couple of months ago. So if you store sensitive information in environment variables, it basically means that the hacker would be also able to steal it. So what would be the solution in this case? Again, I don't know the right answer, but I know the answer that would at least make the potential hacker more difficult. The solution is called HashiCorp Vault. I'm pretty sure that some of you might be familiar with it. So the idea of Vault is very simple. You do not store any information inside of your app. You set up a special service, Vault. It is open source, you can download it. At least basic version is fully open source, so you can install it for free. And then, if you need any credentials, you just request this Vault. So if you need the connection to the Facebook, you request by key this secret information. Why it is more secure? First of all, because it audits all requests. So one of the most important things in the security is not only about the security itself. It is about the auditing, having all logs of access to your sensitive information. If you have the logs and you are sure that they are true, you would be able at least know what was wrong and what data you lost. Because the worst scenario is that when you know that some data you lost, but you actually don't know what kind of data you've lost. So HashiCorp Vault has the audit log inside of it. Another thing is related to the administrative policy. Okay, you know that something is wrong. So what shall you do? You would go manually to the servers and disable the credentials or remove them. So what would be your steps? How to do this very fast? In terms of Vault, you can just close it. There is a special command that just closes the Vault, and it is closed, and nobody can access it. And you can provide these keys for closing the Vault to different persons, to your CTO, to your CEO, to your security officer, to your DevOps. So it would be possible with one key to close the whole Vault. If you want to open it again, you need all these keys to do that. So there are a few ways. The third way, and very interesting thing, is dynamic secrets. One of the challenges working with external APIs is that you have to be careful when you provide the access. For example, that's a common scenario when you have a mobile app that stores information in Amazon S3, for example. I've seen a lot of examples when the developers put Amazon keys directly inside of mobile app. The logic was the following. You cannot get the source code because the application is compiled, so it is secure. The actual answer is no, because you can decompile application, and that's actually not difficult. And if you decompile the application, you get this private key, and if you have a shared key between different users, so then the hacker would get access to the whole Amazon bucket. So Vault supports by default dynamic access. So how it works? It works a very simple scenario. You provide to the Vault root password of your Amazon account. Nobody after that can get it. It is fully inside of Vault, so you cannot get it at all after that. But when an application requests some actions in Amazon, the Vault would grant exactly the requested level of permissions. So Vault would manage how many options the specific software or the specific request needs. And then, when the request is completed, the credentials would be flushed. So it's like one-time credential access. And that's really cool, first of all, because it is free. At least for now, for Amazon, you can create these credentials for free, so you don't pay for that. And second, even if somehow these credentials would be lost, they will be closed right after the request. So there is no security leak. So you can imagine really a lot of different scenarios how to use Vault. I've just mentioned a few of them. Just go to the website, check their examples, check get started. That's really easy to do. And it would create, again, another layer of your security. It wouldn't protect you from the hackers, because if hacker is familiar with Vault, for sure this hacker would be able to get the information. But again, it would take one more second, one more minute, one more hour. And this would be the time you would be able to do something. And the last thing I would talk is about the encryption. Sometimes you have to encrypt the data. Of course, the best scenario is when you do not store any information. When you, for example, need to get credit card data, you can just outsource this to PayPal or Stripe or any other thing. But sometimes you have to do that. So if you have sensitive information, the easiest way is just to encrypt some data. And there are some software you can use for that. If you are using Symfony, and I'm pretty sure that's the case, there is a Doctrine encrypt bundle that has built-in encryption functionality. It works really good on small projects. On difficult projects, it would be a good idea to use your own listeners, because, okay, it encrypts and decrypts several times instead of one, especially when you have a lot of listeners. So, but that would be one of the case. So if you need to do, for example, an integration with external API, and for some reason you cannot get tokens because of that API, you have to store login and password in your database, but at least do not store them in plain text. Just encrypt them, and it would add, again, another level of the security. So let me summary. I'm not a security officer. I'm not a hacker. I don't know too much about the security. But what I know is that I know that there are few simple ways how to be hacked, and it is not a good idea to think about difficult security workflows when there is much more easy way how to hack you. So here are a few things you can do to be protected from simple attacks. I would say that if you implement all of them in your work and work of your colleagues, it would increase your security much more than you can do with any other custom things. And again, constant vigilance. Thank you.